Hi everyone, this is Kasia Zmokla from Digital Art Classes. Welcome to my channel. So the big news of today is that Capture One made it official and the newest version, Capture One 21, is now available. So being on the subscription model, I have of course downloaded the newest version and I have just played around with the new features for a few hours. I have just downloaded it a couple of hours ago and I want to share with you my feedback. So there are a few features that I got really excited about. They will be super useful and there are some that I'm not that crazy about. So let's jump right into it. Okay, so let's talk about the new features of Capture One 21. I want to begin with the new asset management. So the import got faster, the import window got redesigned, it got improved. So depending on if you are working with a session or if you are working with catalog, the import window will behave a bit differently. So as you can see, I have a session opened and if I just click on the import, this is the new redesigned import window. This is how it's going to look like from now on. So the main thing that has changed here is that now you can more precisely set where your images are going to be imported to. So you can set here in destination. So if you are working with a session, you can send your images either to capture folder, session folder, selected, and so on. You can even choose manually custom folder. If you would be working with a catalog, if you click the import button, you will have here available the catalog related options. So this is really the new thing in the import window. The other thing is that you can go through the images that got loaded. So I'm importing the images from assigned folder. This is my selection and here I can either select all of them by ticking this little button here. I can deselect, so now nothing is selected. And what is made really simple, I can just click on particular image and I can use arrows on my keyboard. I can go basically in each direction. I can go up, down, left, right. And when I hit space on the keyboard, I will be actually selecting the images that I like and that I want to import. So this is everything that is new about the new import window. So that way I have selected those images. I can again select all, I can deselect all. So this is how you can work with this window. So having several images selected, you can hit import two images. So because I have just selected two and they will be imported to the folder that you have assigned just here. Okay, so let's close this, let's cancel. So apart from the new import window, apparently the speed of importing images and the speed of browsing sessions or catalog got improved. But as I've just mentioned at the very beginning, I'm just working with the Capture One 21 for a few hours, 2 or 3 hours. So I wouldn't say that I have noticed any significant difference. But I wasn't working with huge amounts of images as well, and I wasn't performing really complicated edits. So today I'm just sharing my first impressions, and when I play around a bit longer with Capture One 21, I will come back with more detailed videos. Okay, let's talk now about the Dehaze tool. This is new feature. This tool was not available in any of the previous Capture One versions. Let's see how it works. So basically there is one slider. Let's just try it out. So if I start working with this slider, if I start pushing it towards the right hand side, you can see that it affects the image very, very strongly. It removes the haze, it clears the fog. However, it increases contrast in a very significant way. So if you keep your eye on the histogram, I'm just going to temporarily reset the adjustment, you can see how strongly the data has shifted. So in the original image, let me zero out the adjustment. So on the image before applying the dehaze, we had basically no darks. We have just this gap of information to the left-hand side, which indicates we have no dark tones at all. We have no blacks, we have no dark shadows. We have mid-tones, we have plenty of bright mid-tones, and we have some highlights. We are not clipping the highlights though. So what happened when I applied my dehaze amount on the positive value? So when I start pushing the slider towards the right-hand side, you can see that the data in the histogram gets shifted towards the left-hand side, which means that the image gets darkened. So if I go even further, you can see that now we actually have some dark midtones in the image. We have some shadows which were not present there in the original version. So let's take a look again before and after. So this is how the dehaze tool works. So first of all, I want you to take a note that it affects contrast very, very strongly, plus it affects colors very strongly as well. As you can see, it has increased saturation of the colors very significantly. So again, let's just see before and after. So I would say this is quite logical, because if we dehaze, if we remove the haze, then there is no more such a strong aerial perspective and the colors in a natural way will get stronger. However, personally, I'm not that fond of Capture One adjusting automatically my colors in such a strong way. So I don't like such a saturated colors, so I would still work further on color grading and fine-tuning those super saturated colors. So the question that you might ask here is this enough just to use the dehaze slider? As you can see, it produces quite nice results and we can accompany it with some other adjustments. So first of all, I would work with my levels. So if I go on auto levels, I got my highlights a little bit brighter. I got still a little bit more contrast, but the image got clearer. And now I would work with my HDR tool to recover some highlight detail. So let's jump over to the HDR tool and let's push my highlight slider to the left. So now the image got more balanced. We don't have this strong division between the sky and the rest of the image anymore. And we got some of these details revealing here, and we can now add a little bit more of clarity. So this will add a little bit of contrast to the midtones, and this will add punch to the image. So I would say that our dehaze amount, 80, this is way too much. We can move back a little bit and we can be quite satisfied with the result. So if I hit Y, this is the original image before applying any adjustment. So it's washed out, there is no contrast, the sky is basically overexposed, and this is what I got just with these few clicks. So you might ask, is this enough just to use the dehaze tool and forget about any other methods that we would use before to dehaze the image? The clarity, levels, adjustments, working on color. So my honest answer, even after just a couple of hours of working with this feature, I would say that if I spend more time and if I would be working with layers, if I would be working more precisely with my luminosity adjustments, with clarity adjustments, and with color grading, I would say that the effects would be better, simply because we would focus on particular areas in the image. But this feature, this tool, can be a great starting point, so it can indicate you the direction that you can work towards. So if you have images that have some fog, that have some haze in them, you can definitely use the dehaze tool and you can work with the tool. You can see what can be done. So basically, this is one of the ways that you can work with this tool. If you go towards the positive values, you are dehazing the image, you are adding contrast. But you can work with negative values, and that way you will be basically adding fog, you will be adding haze to the image. And this can be done on layers, so you can work with this as targeted adjustments. So let me add new field adjustment layer, and this one let's call haze. So here we will actually add haze to the image. So by working with negative values here, by pushing the slider towards the left-hand side, we are actually adding the fog, we are adding haze to the image. And this can be combined with the previous layer. So here I have now my layer visible, I have my mask visible, excuse me. So I can now invert the mask and I can work with my brush and add the haze in selected areas in the image. So let me just quickly pick brush. Let's adjust the size. I'm going to go for lower flow. I want to have nice transitions. I want to basically blend the fog in. So now if I will be painting over selected areas in the image, as you can see, I'm making these areas brighter and I'm adding fog. This is apparently quite processor heavy, so Capture One is still calculating. I think this is too strong, so I'm going to actually Control Z twice to get rid of this, and let me just go again. So, okay, my flow was way too high. This is eraser, let's go for the brush. So the flow, let's go for really low value, something maybe around 8. Let's just check. So my mask is should be empty. I have hit M to get the preview of the mask. So it is calculating, okay, it is empty. Now I hit M again and I can start painting. So basically I want to just try it out. I have painted over the tops of these trees and you can see that working that way, you can introduce the fog in the areas that you want to. So on the first layer, we've been removing the haze and now you can combine it actually with the layer where you are working with the targeted adjustment. So you can actually add some fog. So this can be done on a layer. If you are working with images that have already some saturated colors, I would be careful with high dehaze values because you can cause artifacts. This basically creates quite a strong color shifts and you can get in trouble. One thing that I actually forgot to mention here, and this is very, very important, that when you are working with the dehaze tool, by default, Capture One is picking the shadow tone automatically, but you have the possibility of picking the shadow tone manually. You can use the picker to do this, and this actually can have a really strong effect on your images. So depending on the area where you will click, it will both shift the luminosity adjustments and it will shift colors. So let's now click somewhere, let's say, inside this fog cloud here, because what this means is that the Capture One picks the shadow tone from the area that it believes that the haze occurred in your image. So let's click somewhere here, the image got darker. So you can see that depending on the area that you will click, let's now click in the warmer part, let's say maybe here. So depending on the area where you will sample, it will affect colors. So now the overall colors have changed as well. If I click here in this dark part, this will change the luminosity adjustment. So actually we have more detail visible here. Maybe if I zoom in a bit more, this will be more visible. So let's again take a look here at these trees and let's click somewhere in the yellow grass. So this part got a little bit more flat. Let's now click somewhere in the sky. So this is a bit of trial and error, but definitely you should use this, especially if you are not happy with the shadow tones picked by Capture One automatically. So let's go back to the auto adjustments and you can see how strongly it affects the image. So don't forget about this. This is very, very important, and take advantage of this option that you can actually pick those shadow tones manually. I'm going to show you the next thing, and this is the feature that I got really excited about, and this is the speed edit. But before we do just that, I want to mention the tool tips that you for sure have noticed when I've been hovering over the tools. So this is the new feature in Capture One 21 as well. If you are new to Capture One, for sure you will enjoy this. So depending on the tool, you can hover over and you can access some very quick help. So this works for almost every tool. For some of them, you have just descriptions. For some of them, you can play videos, you can watch tutorials. So this can be really, really helpful. If you already are familiar with Capture One tools, and if you find this sort of annoying, you can switch this off. You can go to Capture One preferences, and here in the general, you can find this here. So you can switch it off tooltips, show enhanced tooltips. You can switch off as well the resource hub, and that way you won't see those tooltips anymore. And by the way, if you're getting value from my videos, I would really appreciate if you leave me thumbs up on this video, if you consider subscribing to my channel, and if you leave me a feedback, if you leave me a comment down below. I'm always super curious on your feedback and I reply to every single comment under my videos. So please do so. I will really, really appreciate it. Okay, so let's focus now on the new feature that I got really excited about, and I'm talking about the speed edit workflow. So what is this? In Capture One 21, this is the new feature that was introduced, and it is based on regular keyboard shortcuts. So it is designed to basically make you work faster without looking at the sliders, without looking at tools. You can assign your own keyboard shortcuts and you can just switch off tools, you can get rid of your browser and you can focus entirely on your image. So I can imagine this is designed for people who have limited space. For example, if they are working on the go, if they are working with their laptops, this can be super, super helpful because you are working on a small screen, and if you can get rid of tools, this can be really nice. So let's just get back our tools and the browser for the moment back, and let me just show you where you can actually find these new keyboard shortcuts. So all you have to do is to just move over to the edit and go to edit keyboard shortcuts, and here you have the list of all the new hot keys. So the whole idea behind this workflow is super simple. Now all you need to do is to just hold down assigned key and then change the value for your particular adjustment, either with your mouse, trackpad, or even with the arrow keys on your keyboard. So we have these keys that are set by default, and I'm going to actually add my new keyboard shortcut for Dehaze. So these keyboard shortcuts are actually quite logically assigned. If you take a look at them and if you take a look at your keyboard, you can see that they are basically in a row. So Q, W, E, and R are in one row on the keyboard. So it might look sort of strange and difficult to memorize, but it is actually not. And I can help you out. I have prepared a printable PDF with all these keyboard shortcuts, so you can get it. The link is down below under this video. You can just download the printable PDF and you will have the cheat sheet, so you will have all these keyboard shortcuts available. So as I just mentioned, I want to assign my own keyboard shortcut for Dehaze. By default, there is no shortcut yet. So let's say we have all these letters taken. Let's say I will go for 3. So I have hit 3. All I need to do is to just close. So Capture One is known for this, that you can customize almost everything, and this can be really helpful. It can save you a lot of time if you are using specific adjustments and if you want to basically use your own keyboard shortcuts to work faster. So let me just get rid of the tabs. Let me just get rid of the browser. Let's zoom in on the image and let's actually see how does it work. So first of all, I would like to start with decreasing a bit of the exposure value on the image. And actually not, because I want to apply a bit of the new feature. I want to dehaze the image. And since dehaze shifts data in the histogram, since it increases contrast so strongly, I would recommend applying dehaze before any luminosity and HDR adjustments. So let's apply dehaze at the very beginning of this super quick edit. So I have assigned number 3 to dehaze. So all I need to do is to just press and hold 3 on my keyboard. You can see that I have this little slider visible here at the bottom under my picture. And now if I want to increase the dehaze amount, so I will be basically dehazing the image, I'm working with my mouse, so I need to left click and just drag the mouse either to the right or upwards. So by dragging it to the right, I'm increasing my value. I have now the dehaze amount around 58, 60. So it got really nice effect. So that way I'm dehazing my image without the tools, without looking at the tools. Okay, so as the second step, I want to recover some detail in the sky. And in order to do this, I will be working with the HDR tool. So let me just quickly move back to the tools. So by default, Capture One has assigned the hotkeys to the basic adjustment. So you have the keyboard shortcut for the white balance, for the exposure tab, for HDR, for clarity. We have assigned our custom shortcut for dehaze, and there is a shortcut for levels. So you can adjust the blacks, the midtones, and the white point accordingly. And one more thing you might have noticed here, that they have made those sliders in color. Before they were just looking as these other sliders down below. So now if you want to adjust your white balance, this is more intuitive, because you can see that going to the left, you will be cooling your image. Let's maybe try this out. So if I would decide that this image is too warm, and if I want to push it towards the cooler side, I can just go like this, and I can do this as well with my keyboard shortcut. So let's just zero this out. So the hotkey that controls the Kelvin temperature is 1. So if I press and hold 1 and drag my mouse towards the left, I'm going on the cooler side with my temperature. If I would like to adjust tint, I need to use the hotkey 2. So let me just switch off the tools and let's now work on recovering some detail in the highlights. So I will be working with the HDR tab with highlights. So the hotkey is A. I need to just press and hold the A key on my keyboard, then left click and drag my mouse towards the left hand side. So that way I'm recovering some detail in the sky. Let's now add a little bit of clarity to the mix. So the clarity, the hotkey that controls clarity is Z. So let's press Z and let's move towards the right. So that way I'm adding punch to the image. I'm adding contrast to the midtones. We can try to open up those shadows as well. So for this, I need the hotkey for HDR shadows, and this will be S. So here I want to be very subtle. Let's go for something like this. And actually, to get back more details, I want to add one more layer. So I just want to quickly add new field adjustment layer, and on this one I want to go further with my highlight recovery. So I'm pressing and holding A and dragging the slider to the left So the sky got darker and I have still more detail visible here. I want to go a little bit stronger with my clarity. So let's go for Z and let's push it still a bit further. So I'm starting with the value at zero because I'm on my new adjustment layer. But if we would go on the background layer, we can see that already clarity was applied at the value 31. So now if I'm on the background layer and if I press and hold Z, I can see already that we are not zeroed out here, that I would be adding clarity starting from 31. So this is how you would be working with the new speed workflow. I would really recommend trying this out. This is really fun. At the beginning, I was quite skeptical, but actually the more I use it, I'm getting more and more excited. And I'm on my big Retina Mac. I can't wait trying this out on a small laptop. And one more thing that I want to show you in relation to the speed edit is that you can actually speed edit multiple images. So let me just jump to a different session. So here I have already selected four images. And one thing that I want to mention is that if you are working on multiple images, so I have four images selected now, make sure that you have this icon enabled. So edit selected, this will apply the adjustment to all selected images. The adjustments will be applied always to the background layer. So no matter if I would have this layer selected and if I would be working with the speed edit workflow on multiple images, the adjustment will always go to the background layer. Okay, so let's switch off our tools and let's say that now here I would like to recover detail in the sky. So I will be working with the HDR tool with the highlights, so the hotkey is A. Make sure that the edit selected is switched on, so the adjustment will affect all images at once. So I'm pressing and holding A, left clicking with my mouse and dragging the slider towards the left. You can see that four sliders appeared under every single image and we can see how this adjustment is performing. So I want to go, let's say, all the way to the left. So that way I have recovered detail in the sky. So you can continue working that way. Now let's say we can add some clarity. I know that this video is already getting long, but I'm really excited about this. I enjoy working with these features a lot. So you can see that on these three last images, there was already clarity applied. So I have started with the number, I believe, around 80. The first one is way softer. So if I would like to just work on this one independently, I need to switch this off, have this image selected. So this is indicated by this Y border around the image. And I need to repeat this. So I need to press and hold Z and go towards the right hand side. So I can still see the other images as a reference, but now because I have switched off this icon, I'm only applying clarity to this very first image. And just to show you that I'm working only with this one because there are no birch trees visible, so the effect is not that strongly affecting the image. Let's say I want to open up shadows. So I will be working with the hotkey S. So let's hit S and left click and let's drag the mouse towards the right hand side or upwards. So you can see that I am opening those shadows only in the first image. If I would like to apply these adjustments to all the images, all I need to do is to just switch this on, and now if I will repeat this adjustment, I'm adjusting all the images at once. Okay, and one more thing that I would like to mention here is that now you can adjust your brush without using any sliders either. So let's just hide the browser, we'll have a little bit more space. So if I just select my brush, before you could right-click and you could use these sliders to change the size, hardness, opacity, and flow. Now you don't need to do this anymore. You can use the keyboard shortcuts and you can use your mouse. These keyboard shortcuts will be included in my PDF cheat sheet that is available for you to download, the link down below. So the keyboard shortcuts to change the size of my brush are Control, Alt, and I need to left click and drag either to the left to go lower with the size, or I can go to the right, and that way I'm increasing size of the brush. On a Mac, these keyboard shortcuts are Control, Option, left click and drag left or right, and on a Windows you have Alt and right click and drag left or to the right. You can find it in the PDF cheat sheet. So this is really all for me. I'm the Fujifilm and Nikon camera user. So these are the features that I'm the most excited about. There are a few more things. So for example, in Capture 121, they have introduced the Pro Standard ICC color profiles, and they are available for selected camera models. So if you are working with top-end camera, you can just jump over to the color tab, and here in the base characteristics, you can check if there is the new Pro Standard color profile. So for me, there is nothing new, but you can basically find, I will include the link down below, the list of the selected camera models, so you can check if your camera model is covered with this. So basically, the new camera profiles preserve original colors better. So if you are working on product photography, you will have to spend less time on fine-tuning these colors and making them basically as close to the real object as possible. Another feature is that Capture 121 supports the HEIC files. So these files you basically produce if you are working with Apple devices, if you are working with iPhone, or if you are taking your images with the iPad. So you can switch those devices to capture RAW files, basically the HEIC files. These are the Apple RAW files, and you can then import them inside Capture One and work on them with Capture One. And the last feature that I want to mention in this video, this is for the Leica users. If you have Leica S3 or Leica SL2, and if you would like to shoot tethered, now these two cameras got supported tethering inside Capture 121. So these are the new Capture One features. If you want to see the full list, you can go over to Capture One's page. But for me personally, the two tools that I will be for sure using and testing out is the new Dehaze tool and the Speed Edit workflow. So thanks for watching, and see you by now.